Bon dia. Tenho muito prazer de apresentar a vós a reflexão derivada de la minha mais recente investigação. Podia falar em portuñol, pero como que é un simposio internacional, falaré en inglés e depois podem, se vós volen, falar en portuñol. So, first of all, let me thank the persons who are responsible for me being here. First of all, my dear friend Fernando Enrique Cardoso, with who have shared projects and life for 47 years now, Fernando, and certainly the Champalimaud Foundation and her president, its president, Ms. Leonor Bellezza, and my interlocutor during all this process, Andrew Tasker. I also want to acknowledge my friend Miguel Darcy from Brazil and my dear friend Antonio Damasio, who also was part of the conspiracy in relationship to the foundation. Let me first of all to place the meaning of my intervention in this scientific meeting in the broader context of what you are trying to do in these 2 days of a wonderful seminar. For me, the understanding and prospects of the problems of humanity require as a precondition to place this understanding from the perspective of the subject of the understanding. And this is the human species as a collective of conscious subjects. For instance, concerning the prospects of climate change, it is not the planet that is in danger, but the livability of the planet for the human species. Without us, the planet as such might be much better off. Therefore, in a long-term perspective, the critical matter refers to the forms of social organizations of our species. The threat to interpret this social organization is that relationships between humans are constructed, have always been constructed, around power relations. Power relations in their naked and restrained expression lead to violence and ultimately to the destruction of life. And therefore, in a long-term perspective, human history has been characterized always by the search for institutions of governance that bring the interests and desires of extremely diverse individuals into a compatibility mode that makes shared survival possible. Power relationships are still the foundational relations of society, but they are filtered by institutions in processes of domination, counter-domination, and negotiation. The legitimacy of these institutions, always in terms relative to their historical context, is critical to the survival and advancement of the species. And what we are witnessing today is a fundamental erosion of the institutional model of representative democracy that appeared as a possible stable solution for governance in the last century. So in this lecture, I will succinctly describe the contours of the crisis, suggest hypotheses on the causes of this crisis, explore some of the current alternatives that are being proposed in socio-political practices around the world, and only then I will be able to imagine 100 years from now in dystopian and utopian perspectives. So first of all, I start from the fact that there is a massive crisis of legitimacy of representative democracy as it is experienced in most countries of the world. Not of the idea of democracy. People do support the idea of democracy. They are extraordinarily critical of the practices of democracy. By crisis of political legitimacy, I understand the rejection by humans of the results of their delegation of decision-making in their representatives and their institutions of governments. Empirically, we observe in most of the world, as I have been able to give some data for you to look directly and, on this issue, so to save time for the actual communication of ideas, but we observe that the majority of citizens in the world do not feel represented by their parliaments or governments, that political parties and politicians are universally considered to work for themselves, not for the people. Politicians are personally despised in very pejorative terms. Media are distrusted. The institutions of society are absolutely distrusted, and most people see corruption everywhere. These trends have always been present, but they are increasing over time. Also, I can show a few slides now to focus. You have the data anyway, but I want to focus some slides so that you can see visually some of these issues. So basically, democracy is important, but what happens with democracy, as you will see in the slides, is rejected at this point, and it's rejected everywhere. So this is a fact, but of course we need to know why, and then we should elaborate, and I would like to elaborate, on the relationship between what human action, conscious human action can do, and this current crisis, which is not a catastrophic natural process. It is a social process that can be acted upon. Which are the sources of this crisis of democracy? Among others, the most important seem to be, first of all, the non-separation of powers in governance and in society. Montesquieu is superseded. The power of money is the fourth power. The power of media is the fifth power. And it is the space where overall power is played out. Executive and legislative are linked via political parties. The judiciary is largely dependent on the political system. The state is dominated by civil service, a self-appointed power, only partially submitted to political power. Second major cause is the professionalization of politics. Politics as a profession with its own corporatist interests. This is an old phenomenon. Mikkels in the 1920s already talked about the bureaucratization of parties, but it has accentuated over time. Two brilliant journalists in Italy coined the term la casta, which is now used universally, has become a new term in politics. By la casta, we refer to the formation of a political class that has common interests as a political class, right or left or center. They first of all come their interests as politicians, as the political class, keeping the monopoly of power within the borders of this class. Therefore, it derives in networks of patronage. The political class becomes a closed world, separated from society. And in some cases, we are seeing the emergence of an interesting phenomenon in democracy, which is the emergence of dynasties, the Clintons, the Bushes, the Kirchnerses, and so many others around the world. Everybody trying to reproduce not only its power as a caste, but the power as a family. We go back to aristocracy. Third reason, seems to me, politics is now media politics, fundamentally. Media politics is therefore requires a personalization of politics, an actor, a figure that can represent and convey a message. That is directly linked to the emergence of scandal politics as the fundamental form of political practice. Since politics is personalized, destroying the person is destroying the political adversary. And everybody does it. I have analyzed the effects of scandals on political practice. Well, scandals do not necessarily bring down the person who is object of the scandal. For instance, President Clinton lied into the eyes of Americans about his affair in the White House. He ended his term as the most popular president of the United States. So something else, of course, for a substantial number of the population, that was immorality, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So what the effect of a scandal and why people, there were studies, why people still accepted Clinton. Say, well, everybody's a liar in politics. Everybody's corrupt. So I prefer my liar and my corrupt to the other ones. And he's more charming. So fundamentally, the issue here, what has been shown, is that it's not necessarily the target of the scandal. It's the entire political system. It's the demise of everybody. Right? So one day is one, another day is another one, but all together is a downward spiral for the entire political class. Corruption is the major source of the crisis of politics, and the origins of corruption are largely in the finance of media politics. Media politics is very expensive. What is assigned to the political parties is never enough to pay for that. So corruption is an integral part of the political system nowadays. In some countries, there is also the decisive importance of the criminal economy that transforms, in corruptive terms, most of the function of the institutions. Another cause that has been advanced for the deep crisis of legitimacy, the contradiction between globalization of issues and the national limits of politics. The reaction against this gap between the global issues and the national politics has been tried to be filled in by the creation of networks between states. That is, that the states together share some sovereignty, some competency, to be able to together act on the global issues. But by doing so, they increase the distance between the citizen at the level of life, at the level of the everyday life, at the level of local existence, and the institutions of the representation. This is why there is also not only a crisis of legitimacy, but a deep crisis of legitimacy of the supranational institutions, particularly in the case of the European Union. The data show this massive distrust of the European Union institutions in all the countries, including, of course, Portugal. The continuation of these trends leads to a separation between society and its institutions. This separation is untenable in the long term under the conditions of democracy and may actually lead to authoritarian imposition of the rules of governance, as a number of political trends show these days everywhere. Therefore, against this order of things, there are social protests, social movements of the new kind. I just published a book titled Networks of Outrage and Hope on the New Forms of Social Movements Emerging Everywhere, and I show the power of this movement these days. However, on the one hand, this powerful impact of this social movement can be detected in terms of the change of the minds of the people, in terms of the change of attitudes, but it's actually very weak in the transformation of the institutional system, with some exceptions. Main one in the European context is Spain. It's a little bit maybe in other southern countries, certainly in Greece, a little bit less in Portugal and Italy. And it's very powerful besides Portugal, very powerful in Brazil. One should remind that social movements come in all formats. There are social movements that are conservative, social movements that are revolutionary, social movements that are on the traditional left or on the new left. In other words, the power of this social movement is independent of their ideology and goals. And in fact, they are usually very confused and very diverse in terms of ideology. But the impact, they do have it, but the impact is mainly on the minds of the people. More and more starts filtering down into the institutions, but by and large, still what we see is a bubbling of society, of civil society, but with a still being constrained in terms of the ability to change and modify and innovate the institutions of representation. So the issue is, and that's what I really want to discuss today with you, is it necessary reinventing democracy, and how in different experiences and different countries this reinventing of democracy is proceeding? Well, first of all, to be fair to liberal democracy, some forms of representative liberal democracy seem to work to the satisfaction of their citizens in a very few countries, mainly Scandinavia. One could add New Zealand, but that would take us too far away from this topic. But the case of Scandinavia is actually exceptional. Even about 10 years ago, I was in the Talbert Forum in Sweden, in the presence of the Swedish king and Swedish dignitaries, and I proposed, and Kofi Annan was there because his wife is Swedish, and I proposed that as Scandinavia should be declared an endangered species for humanity, and tours of children from all over the world should go there to visit what could have been in terms of democracy before everything collapsed. The king didn't like it at all. But there are limits to generalize from the relatively successful experiences of Scandinavia. And this is analytically significant. These are ethnically and culturally homogeneous society by and large until recently. That's very important. Second, they had been socially cohesive through policies of redistribution after a protracted class struggle, in some cases very violent, like the atrocious civil war in Finland in 1918-19. And even in these societies, there is a decrease in legitimacy. It's still only the countries where the legitimacy is over 50%, but it's declining. There is also a dark side in this society, like has been shown, and even in the literature, the sympathies of some part of the Swedish and other elites for Nazism during World War II. And recently, I remind you that Norway, Denmark, and Finland have in the government xenophobic parties. Particularly interesting for me that I work quite a bit on Finland, in the case of Finland, one of the most democratic countries in the world, that 8 years ago witnessed the birth of a new party called the True Finns that didn't exist, and they won 20% of the vote in the first election with only one point in their program: do not help Portugal. Why Portugal? Because we're the moment in which the rescue of Portugal was being debated, and they decided that the nation should rise against the waste of helping those Portuguese. Well, they got 20%, and now they are in the government in alliance with the Conservatives. And the Swedish Democrats is an openly pro-Nazi party, quadrupled their seats in the parliament in the last election. So a relatively harmonious political construction in Scandinavia is also slowly fading away. So we do need to pay attention to which are the efforts to regenerate democracy that may project a better future. Because this is my argument. With all the things that we may know about the evolution of the problems of humankind, with everything we can have in terms of scientific perspective, if we do not treat the agency of the process, if we do not reflect on the fundamental destruction of the institutions of sharing life and governance, everything else is beautiful ideology. But whatever the debates are, the subject determines the object, because that's what historical practice shows us. So, which are the projects of reform of liberal representative democracy? First of all, procedural reform. The reforms of the procedure has usually has been accepted widely the perspective that democracy is about procedure of deliberation and decision making. a procedure that maximizes access to diverse actors, values, and interests, and gives a fair chance to most citizens to participate in democracy. From this perspective, the remedy to the crisis of legitimacy refers to a number of measures that would correct the deviations from the representative model, such as limiting influence of the money on politics, limiting donations, forcing disclosure of donors and setting up a register of legitimate donations, legalizing and controlling lobbies, watching and publishing under undue influence by matching donors and votes deputy by deputy and party by party. All this is there in the public debate. As usual, programs are wonderful until you look into the fine print and into the details. So which are the problems? Well, in some countries, like a relatively marginal country like the United States, free spending is considered a right of free expression by the Supreme Court. Okay? Therefore, it's no limit to what parties or committees linked to the political system can be spending in donations. So it is legitimate. Legitimation donations fundamentally unbalances politics toward the politics of money. Politics has become a matter of entrepreneurialism. Who is the actor, because in fact it's individual actors, who is able to raise funds first and more largely. However, thinking beyond the United States, when limits are established, donations are still present, but in the obscurity, therefore criminalizing politics. Or it becomes clearly rewards and favors to the donors after parties and leaders are in office. And this is universal. 3% in Catalonia for any public work or public market, systematically practiced for 30 years by the Catalan Nationalist Party, the Mensalão by the PT in Brazil, the Bankia network by the PP in Spain. Public work is really a critical matter, but also there are other forms. Regulatory measures, for instance, in the media, Murdoch. Murdoch has always based his political influence in exchanging media favors for regulations that favor his media groups. Berlusconi, he just did it for himself. He was both in government and in business, and he organized the regulatory system around his personal interests. Or in financial institutions, the one power that has always existed at the heart of the White House cabinet, regardless of the Democrats or Republicans present, is Wall Street. Wall Street is always there and is always controlling key political decisions. Or the chemical industries fighting against the environment. The Koch industries, major chemical oil group, determines nowadays large part of American politics, including the financing of the Tea Party. And lately, by the way, also financing political demonstrations in Brazil. So some people say, well, yes, these are rotten apples. They are individuals, not parties. Well, the rotten apples are most of the crop of the apple these days. And particularly, there is no separation between parties and individuals. Individuals act on behalf of parties, and they take a cut on it. This is what empirical evidence shows. So there are measures to control. Control of accounting, declaration of assets, but there are many indirect ways to channel the funding. This is a specialized business nowadays. It's one of the major businesses in the world, how to channel illegally funds from certain donors to the political parties and political leaders. There is a partial solution that is practiced in many countries, which is the public financing of parties, but it has two problems. First, that it's not enough. Second, the public financing is according to the votes that the party already had, and therefore it reproduces the power of the party that are already powerful. All over the world, fighting corruption has become the main slogan of most institutions and political actors. Corruption is relatively different from donations. It's a direct exchange of money and favors, although it's a blurred line there. When corruption comes from inside the government, it is difficult to prove because traces are blurred. There are in society some mechanisms of control of these processes of corruption, and I want to show the problems with this supposedly control mechanism. The media, so the media can denounce, and therefore corruption is exposed. But the scandals are selective, and when the media reports is selective because it's usually fed by the parties themselves or by certain people in the parties against their own people in the parties. There are very few true independent investigative journalists that unveils corruption because the information is too hidden. The parties feed the leaks on the media. In fact, there are a number of specialized companies which are in the business of what they call it finding dirt. A few years ago in the United States, Stephen Marks wrote a book, Confessions of a Political Hitman, explaining in detail the emergence and the formation of major companies, consulting companies, called Opposition Research, OR, to find damaging information about whatever candidate or whatever political party in whatever election had to be exposed. Actually, he said that among ourselves, we call ourselves rat fuckers, because that's what they do. And they work indifferently for any party or any person or anything. They are in the open market. Not Republican, not Democrat, not left, not right. You just pay me and I find something. And they always find something. That's the critical thing. They always find something. I don't know if they make it up, but they always find something that ends up in the media. The problem with that is that it's not some people against others, some parties against the other. Everybody does it. Everybody, every party. And why? This I have talked personally to some party leaders sometimes. Because everybody else does it. So unless there is an agreement that is implemented, is no way of not doing it. Cannot be unilateral disarmament, to be clear. Second issue, second mechanism of control that had been developed, the judiciary. In fact, this has been the most effective weapon. But the judiciary is politicized itself. And therefore, this leads to the judicialization of politics. Judges are political contenders more and more with their own special interests. And this blurs definitely the separation of powers. For politicians, therefore, appointing judges or influencing judges becomes crucial. There is still also some other mechanisms, such as special units to control corruption, which is, these are only effective if they are truly independent, but usually they don't have much teeth in their sanctions. Or they may be useful if they are linked to an authoritarian charismatic power. There's an example that I knew when I wrote my book on Singapore. Lee Kuan Yew was effective in organizing a special unit anti-corruption linked to the president himself, not reporting to anybody, and was effective. However, after the example that I can give about their procedures is that they found that the Housing Authority of Singapore was corrupt, and that's a major thing in Singapore at that time. After the visit of the anti-corruption unit, the head of the Housing Authority committed suicide. It was not torture or anything. No. They just was presented with a number of consequences for his family that would push him to commit suicide. And many, many other examples of that. So, yes, we may be able to control corruption under such conditions, but you see the implications. In fact, almost every country has an anti-corruption unit, Portugal too. And in almost every country, this unit is the first to be corrupted, because so that the corruption can operate. The key issue, now going deeper into the roots of the problem, is the asymmetry of information between governments, corporations, and citizens. This notion of representative democracy in which people are informed and then they make their own decisions, which is all the rational choice model that political scientists use, they start from a fundamental flaw. There is no symmetry of information. So it's not true that all the political actors, citizens to start with, can make the rational choices. They don't have equal access to media, and the authorities that control media access are only in the electoral campaigns, and the key is every day, not in the electoral campaigns. And when the parties have equal access to the television, to the state television, the, in fact, it's measured in minutes proportional to the seat, so it reproduces power. Yet, we have the internet now, but information that can be legally accessed, in fact, is either not accessible under the conditions of national security or accessible in ways that are so unfriendly that citizens cannot truly manipulate or understand or manage the information. Key mechanisms in blocking representative democracy, the electoral laws. The electoral laws are written by dominant political actors to perpetuate their power. They define districts, the so-called gerrymandering procedure. They set up rules for candidacy and limits to enter parliaments depending on their interest, therefore limiting diversity. And there is almost never the mechanism in which it's one person, one vote. There are all kinds of corrections that block that level of political representation. There is some cases, like Israel, of representative, it is proportional, but this is the exception more than the usual practice. Going into a proportional representation has some problems people have observed. Stability in governance, usually this is a pretext. To protect the interests of minorities and small districts. Different models playing with chamber and senate, one representing citizens in the other territories. However, a paradoxical effect is that the more territories are important, the more special interests rooted in local patronage networks dominate national politics. There are also measures many countries being asked about limiting the terms of the elected officials, even to one term. The problem that forces political leaders to learn on the job, and in fact that gives more power to the party, that the politicians go, the party stays. So overall, this stops professionalization, but lowers the quality of politicians unless they are truly idealist, which is not the case. Democratizing parties under judicial control, forcing to primaries, forcing to rules in the parties, this in fact is also starting to work in a number of countries, but it limits definitely the separation of power between the judiciary and the political system. So, although procedural reforms are necessary, the issue seems to be deeper and deals with the forms of traditional liberal democracy. And therefore, a number of alternatives had been presented and proposed in recent years. I remind you that there always had been some ideological critiques of representative democracy, opposing real democracy, like popular democracy, as in the communist or populist tradition. In fact, these critiques and these models have revealed themselves to be instruments for a monopoly of power by an activist vanguard, self-reproducing the power of apparatuses, and to some extent the dictatorship of popular assemblies not clearly representative. It was an old debate in the left between Rosa Luxemburg and Lenin about that, when Rosa Luxemburg argued against Lenin, when Lenin was saying, all the power to the Soviets as the popular democracy, and she said, no, all the power to the Communist Party, and that's the worst form of democracy. So it's not a simple issue. It's not simply rejecting a representative democracy on behalf of a democracy that ultimately was a miscarriage of true democracy. But there are a number of trends in the world that are trying to reform this crisis of legitimacy. One is participatory democracy as complementary to representative democracy. Decentralized consultative democracy, particularly effective at the local level. The example that is repeated again and again in the world, to some extent has become a myth, is the Orçamento Participativo of Porto Alegre since 1989, the participatory budget, but originally was limited to 2% of the budget. This is a myth also about there. And it grew to 20% today. And the model has been extended to 120 cities in Brazil and also to some state governments like such as Rio Grande do Sul under the impulse of a very innovative politician, Tarso Genro, who uses the internet to organize the participation of the citizenship in the budget of the state. However, there is serious limitation in terms of participation. Only about 5% of residents in Porto Alegre participate in these experiences. And the problem repeats everywhere. There are hundreds of similar local experiments in Latin America, in Scandinavia, in Spain, a number of limited cities in the United States, in Indonesia. Overall, the experience is positive in the sense that small groups that are excluded from power have intervened in the decision-making process. But as a whole, it complements but does not replace representative democracy, and therefore the liberal representative democracy continues to be fundamentally challenged. There is also some attempt to go into new forms of democratic decision-making, electronic democracy. In a world in which 97% of information now is digitized, 3.7 billion people are users of internet social networking, and we have 7 billion numbers of mobile phones, that is, everybody has it. This has prompted a number of projects of the so-called electronic democracy by using digital interaction between citizens and government. In fact, the assembly form of democracy always was recognized as having a direct relationship between people and their delegates. The problem was the lack of scalability. How can we have a national assembly, or even less an international assembly? Well, internet and digital interaction has made possible to escalate. So in that sense, there is a possibility there that could be used if the political will be in place. The most advanced experiment was the Icelandic constitution of 2011-2012, in which 21% of the population participated over the internet in the actual drafting of the constitution. It worked. The problem was that then the parliamentary majority changed and the new conservative majority canceled the Icelandic constitution after it had been elaborated by 21% of the population. Pirate parties in Europe are experimenting with platforms such as Liquid Feedback to deliberate, participate, and vote on issues or to select delegates. The problems, however, of e-democracy are also considerable, particularly on two grounds. Since communication is interactive and flows are multidirectional, governments can surveil and control their citizens even better when everything is in the electronic networks. Second, there is a whole new generation of robots, this is important, trained to participate in political debates over the internet, sometimes disguised as a way to send messages, negative messages, that will antagonize people against their own party, the electorate against their own party. Particularly effective in this technology is the Venezuelan opposition, which in addition to using it in Venezuela, has been hired by other forces to target other parties in other countries. Particularly, there was a massive robot attack against Podemos in Spain, led from the Venezuelan opposition technologists. Russian government also is using robots to diffuse misinformation among the population that would be susceptible to vote against them in the election. So perhaps the most interesting thing is how grassroots democracy can be articulated to internet-based deliberation and decision-making. There are a number of experiences around the world, particularly interesting regardless of the judgment that we can have, and I have a negative one on the ideology, but the movement Five Stars in Italy, the Beppe Grillo movement, has used extensively the internet in electing candidates, debating candidates, intervening in the parliament, etc., etc. Generally under the authoritarian rule of Beppe Grillo. But it has been, in technical and procedural terms, an innovation. New forms of consensus democracy proposals emerged from the Occupy movement, from the Indignados movement, but the moment to go into the political system, difficulties have appeared. However, in the case of Spain, there are two things. These models have influenced all political parties, and not just the political parties resulting from the movement. And second, Podemos, and the new party in Spain, created only in January 2014, has actually implemented a system in which 1,000 territorial groups, local assemblies, and 350,000 members have access to the Agora Podemos, which is a platform of deliberation and decision making, in which they elect the representatives and vote on programs and initiatives. Again, only 12% of the actual members participate in these debates, and again, this does not guarantee the absence of manipulation by the leadership. But there is an experiment on the move. Podemos will enter the parliament next week with a predicted level of vote of 16% of the national vote, behind 25% of the conservatives and 20% of the socialists. And then we will see how much of this interaction between internet and deliberative democracy may happen. So, given the limits of all these reforms, and given the crisis of legitimacy that we observe as an empirical fact throughout the world, should we side with Churchill when he said democracy is the worst form of government except for all other forms that had been tried from time to time? But my problem with that was also the argument in defense of the absolute monarchy that Hobbes presented in his Leviathan. Why the problem of a fair form of government is so intractable? What happens if we project it into the future? So here I go slightly into your perspective. The key structural elements of the malfunctioning of democracy are beyond institutional flaws. They are in the asymmetries existing in the distribution of wealth and in the distribution of information. And both are worsening. I refer you to the famous work by Piketty and the inequality in the world, but it goes into the other analysis going the same direction. The annual report of Credit Suisse, not necessarily a revolutionary organization, shows exactly the same trends in massive inequality in the world, and given the connection between money and politics, this reflects in the increasing asymmetry in politics. And the other one, which is information. Nowadays, we observe using the ability to digitize everything. 97% of information is digitized. We are all digitized and systematized in the computer programs of major national and international bureaucracies. So at this point, in a world of surveillance, in a world of control of information, governments know everything about us. And when they don't know, they ask Google, which definitely knows everything about us. And we know very little. and we try to find something, national security restrictions block the access to information. So we have asymmetry of wealth, asymmetry of information in a politics that is dominated by money and by informational capacity. Yet, the fundamental law in human societies is wherever there is oppression, there is resistance to oppression, always. So a utopian horizon emerges in opposition to the current dystopian trends. The new social movements, with the capacity to access information over the internet, elaborate knowledge, deliberate, decide in a distributed network. This is a material process in practice by millions of people, fed by the utopia of a new democracy, still to be discovered in new historical practices. What this kind of new democracy could be, which is projected, is materially projected in the minds of millions and millions of people, but what could it be? We do not know. But since you are talking about 100 years from now, I imagine 100 years from now, I imagine Antonio, Tim, and myself designing a truly new form of superior democracy. Individual neural networks horizontally networked with other individual networks and extended, augmented by digital communication networks with network participatory institutions running, programming, and instructing machines that would execute in real time the majority decisions in every aspect of real life. To some extent, it is the Internet of Things, decided and constantly modified by neural networks working collectively for the preservation of the social body as the individual brain works for the preservation of the body proper. True, there are few technical and organizational details to be filled in, but there is a more important glitch. For Antonio, Tim, and myself to be around in 100 years from now, we need another scientific breakthrough. So given the uncertainty of the proposition, I would rather conclude with something else. There is an implicit agreement in all the critiques and defense of democracy that democracy is about procedure, institutions, laws, courts, and the problems are those that deviate from the correct functioning of these procedures, for instance, corruption. The problem is that this sidesteps the human nature as historically constructed on the foundation of our biological being. Historical evidence supports Hobbes rather than Rousseau. Therefore, institutions are largely created on the basis of coercion against the potential ill will of the basically Hobbesian subjects, depending on the power relations in each context. Furthermore, Hobbes and Rousseau inhabit all of us at the same time, and we never know who we will be depending on circumstances. Thus, if democracy means betting on the preservation and advancement of the human species as a species in harmony with animals and nature, then procedures cannot be independent from the substance of human life. Democracy as dignity, as similar to the Amartya Sen's version of development as dignity, is not about procedure. It's about of the defense of the basic human rights. In all the social movements I have studied, there is one word that repeats itself, the equivalent in every language, dignity. People fight for dignity. Sometimes include democracy, but main thing, dignity. Brazil, Egypt, Spain, everywhere. Dignity is the word of recent social movements. As for democracy, the one that is accepted within this dignity paradigm is Robert Scarpitti's notion of democracy. Democracy is when they knock the door at 5 a.m. and you think it's the milkman. But which are these human rights and how can they be implemented? Human rights are what the humans imagine, declare, and act upon in every space-time context. Because they are human, they are universal, and so they apply to every human being everywhere. Who will name them? Who will enforce them? Human beings themselves, largely out of their own consciousness, mobilization, deliberation, struggle, creativity, and potentiality for networking their consciousness. Through which means? Through the means available to them in each context, from local gatherings to workplaces to neighborhoods to internet networks to art to sciences to individual experiences and exploration. Through which institutions? Here is my difference with the traditional discussions about democracy. Through institutions adapted to each culture, to each country, to each tradition, to each history and geography. Human dignity is universal, but the institutions of dignity have to be constructed by the human subjects living in their specific circumstances. Should be no more imperialism of any given concept of democracy, being representative democracy or participatory democracy, corresponding to cultures and institutions that happen to be dominant, not because being more civilized, but because more technologically advanced in military terms. It is the demos, each one of the multiple demos, who will decide their own creation and defend it and implement it in a relentless struggle to be the subject of their own history, to be made and remade collectively and individually every day of their lives. This is why there is no model, no God, and no masters, only humans in search for their humanity. Thank you very much.
We will be taking questions from Manuel Castells, but while you're thinking about it, let me ask you. We've all been watching, witnessing these episodes of terrorism happening everywhere. We just watched it in Paris. Apparently, what happened the last couple of days in California is the same thing. And one result that we get from all of that is more authoritarian measures by central governments. The U.S., after September 11, adopted the Patriot Act. There are similar legislation. The French have just decided to live for 3 months under emergency laws. These are attacks on liberty. In the context of what you talk about, erosion of democracy, how do you see the danger of this overreaction, if we can call it overreaction, to terrorism?
Well, you are. I think we absolutely agree. The dominant emotion in humans is fear. And under the conditions of fear, every decision making can be withdrawn from the humans themselves into some machine, some political machine or some state, ultimately. So the more there is violence, and the more there is fear in the population, the easier it is to impose forms of governance which are clearly in contradiction with all the basic democratic principles. So a different matter would be the tactics to combat barbaric terrorism. But the concrete effect in terms of what we are talking about is to increase the pressures toward an authoritarian rule in which the actual liberties that have been proclaimed constitutionally are contradicted and constrained every day. On the other hand, the more governments become authoritarian and the more they undermine their own legitimacy, and therefore the more you have the possibility of citizens turning to violence to express whatever values or interests they think they are not representing. Remember that the key thing about terrorism in Europe is not Syria. It's people who are born and grown up in Europe, few migrants, but in general, who have been excluded from their society, who think they have no rights except voting every 4 years for parties that in any case they don't represent their values and interests, and therefore they resort to some alien power that would enable them to express their rage, first of all, and their ability to impose a dictatorship related to their values. So in other words, terrorism is the result of the weakness of democracy, and at the same time weakens democracy even further, and could only be combated in the long term by societies mobilizing around their own citizens' rights.
Very interesting. Questions? Do I see any hands? Microphones? There is one here, and then the lady over there afterwards.
I would start with the point that Castells emphasized, that democracy is about the human species, about the human beings. And I would challenge him with the following question. My sense is the spheres of freedom are expanding at different levels from the bottom up, in society. In the family, women, gays, localities, regions of the world, there are expanding dynamics of freedom and democracy in the movement. How do you see this? Do you think that these trends can continue to expand, link to each other, affect, influence the structure, the institutions of democracy, or are we going to live increasingly in a kind of dual society with spheres of democracy on the one hand, at the private life, local level, sexual rights or this sort of thing, with demoralized, obsolete, worn-out institutions over there?
Miguel, you touched the essential point, absolutely. That on the one hand, it's not that we don't have increasing freedom. On the contrary, as you mentioned, I will not repeat it, and in addition, the ability to inform ourselves and communicate ourselves through the internet and interactive digital communication network more than ever in the society, in the family, in terms of the human rights, in terms of citizens being able to organize their own process of deliberation. All this does not change, is not represented in these obsolete forms of political representation that had been penetrated by all the other powers that are largely corrupt, are largely delegitimized, and it's precisely this gap between the two forms, between the two expressions of freedom in the society and restrained freedom and lack of control in the level of the political institution. This is what is a dramatic gap. And in that sense, this endangers human ability to live together. That's the critical one. And ultimately, terrorism is the expression of our inability to live together and our inability to manage the tensions, the difference in values, the difference in identities in ways which are not simply the ways of authoritarian repression.
The lady over here in the center there.
Yep. You have listed a long list of the flaws that democracy actually presently is going under. And you emphasized corruption. But you gave yourself the example that an example of how corruption in lato senso can be very well tolerated by society at large, named the case of scandal politics, the case of Clinton, and many other cases that people just forget and, between commas, forgive. How to face corruption? It's a very complicated question, as you put it.
Could you give us your question,
yes,
please?
But
yes, pressed for time.
I know I'm not supposed to make a speech.
Right.
But my question would be, insofar as the decay of democracy is concerned, if people, everyday people, people at large, the masses, are really interested in participating, it seems a futile question. It is not. Because the feeling I have is that nowadays, we in the Western world, we don't live anymore in a spiritual community, in a spiritual universe, and the quest for money, for consumption, for very ephemeral goods is overwhelming.
Therefore, your question is?
No, my question is, when we deal with the problem of the decay of democracy, should we focus just on the flaws that are already apparent, like factionalism, corruption, and so on, the erosion of the institutions, the loss of legitimacy of the institutions, but should we not think in the first place whether people are actually interested in conserving truly democratic forms of government, if self-government is still as important as it seemed to be, because
we'll take a question from there. Could you?
Very short. The actual empirical observations show is that people would like to participate in decision-making, but they don't do it universally because they don't believe in that their input is taken seriously into consideration by the institutions. So because they don't trust the institutions, seems to them to be a waste of time and energy to try to participate. But on the other hand, what we observe is that in terms of the massive expression of social movements, civic organizations, etc., that have happened in the world, people there participate constantly in the interaction in the internet social networks, in assemblies. They don't participate in political parties. They don't participate in the political institutions, but they do participate in any form of self-expression at self-organization that emerges in the world today. It's two cultures.
Okay, we'll take two more questions because we're really getting pressed for time. There was the gentleman here in front first.
You ended with the phrase that they're only humans in search of their humanity. Now, what I would like to know is that is this a process with a destination or is it an endless quest? And is the notion of human fixed or can it be redefined? And if it can be redefined, who redefines it? And then what happens to our humanity?
Can you repeat questions?
Yeah. You ended by saying that there are only humans in search of their humanity.
Yeah.
What I'm asking is that, is this a process with a destination, or is it an endless quest? Are we perpetually going to look for our humanity?
Absolutely.
Or is there a goal that we are going to eventually reach? And the second part of the question is the notion of humanity fixed, or can it be redefined? And if it can be redefined, then who redefines it? And then what happens to our ideas of humanity?
Absolutely. So I will specify the comment on this. So the way of being humans in every aspect is an endless search, as you said. Yes, this is endless, historically endless. And therefore, there are human rights, but the expression and the forms and the organization of how to fulfill this human right is constantly historically produced and reproduced. And therefore, this will continue forever as long as the species is able to reproduce itself. So therefore, my point is that the forms of social organization in terms of institutions of governance that had been created over the past two centuries are obsolete. The empirical observation is that the same humans that live by these rules do not believe in these rules, clearly. And this is an increasing trend. Therefore, it's a new search that has already started. It's a new search for new forms. And what I'm saying is that these forms of new organization, I have detected around the world a number of experiments, a number of projects that are trying to reconstruct. Still nothing very conclusive. The only thing we are sure is that something will have to emerge. And this emergence depends exactly on this endless search in a new historical stage. So the human institutions linked to the defense of human rights in the new context are in the process of being made and will be being made by the subjects themselves, not by any form of bureaucratic decision making by governments who are not legitimate anymore.
This lady here has a question, and what we'll do is after we get an answer from that, then we'll call the other participants, and the rest of you who have questions will have a chance to ask as well. But let me invite then the other participants after this lady asks her question.
Thank you. Professor, looking at the data you have, a continent, that is the African continent, seems not to be in the information age. And that is quite true because your data has very little on the continent. My question is, well, how do you see this new democracy era, the playoff in the Africa continent, maybe 50 years or 100 years from now? Thank you.
Thank you. For the moment, as we probably, as you probably know, the data on democracy and the legitimacy of democracy in Africa are the worst in the world. That's in which corruption is the rule, not the exception, in which elections are systematically frauded, in which the powers, the de facto powers, et cetera, control the political parties and the political representatives. This is exactly one of the things that tells me they attempt to export a form of democracy in terms of procedure from the colonizers to the ex-colonized and say, this is democracy. You just vote and that is. You have democracy. That is fundamentally flawed, but it does not correspond to the reality of the continent. Now, I cannot foresee too many things, but what I can see is that there is increasingly an attempt by, in most African countries, to reject existing illegitimate forms of government and to try to construct new projects on the basis of people's capacity to self-organize and to deliberate. We do have one example, which is still relative, but still is an important example, which is South Africa, in which the mobilization of Africans, particularly of the native African, the black African, was able to transform the false democracy, the apartheid democracy, into forms of democracy which, in relationship to African countries, is more advanced than anyone. However, if there is one country where corruption now is widespread, it's South Africa. So the South Africa has the privilege of having reached then the same level of corruption and, and lack of legitimacy that in the advanced democracies in Europe. But there was a transformation of the system, and that was literally linked to the capacity of the South Africans to struggle for the freedom and participation. 100 years from now, what I doubt that will be here 100 years from now, because if we do not solve the fundamental problem of how to live together, which ultimately is what democracy means, how to live together without destroying each other, I foresee many, many, many serious consequences in terms of devastation, of violence, and the inability to truly reconstruct the human species. That's why, with all modesty, I think that unless we discuss the fundamental problems in the human species themselves as subjects of their own destruction, whatever formula we can find in solving the other problems of the world will be dependent on how we solve the problem of how we live together.
Professor